Good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the fourth meeting of the Public Petitions Committee in 2021. This meeting is being held virtually, and because of connection issues, I will be present in audio only. The first item on our agenda is a decision on whether to take agenda item 3 in private. Do members agree to take item 3 in private? That's agreed. We can then move to agenda item 2. The second item on our agenda today is the consideration of a continued petition, Petition 1804, Halt Highlands and Islands Airport Limited's Air Traffic Management Strategy, lodged by Alistair McKechan, John Doig and Peter Henderson on behalf of Bundy Council. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to halt Highlands and Islands Airports Limited's Air Traffic Management Strategy project, to conduct an independent assessment of the decisions and decision-making process of the ATMS project. And can I welcome Rhoda Grant MSP and Liam MacArthur MSP, who are present for this agenda item. At our last consideration of this petition, the committee agreed to take evidence at a future meeting from representatives of Highland and Islands Airports Limited, and I am pleased to welcome here today Inglis Lyon, Managing Director, Gary Cobb, Chief Operating Officer, and Pat Nolan, ATM Professional Advisor. And may I invite Inglis Lyon to provide a brief opening statement before we move to questions.
Convener, good morning. Good morning, committee. And thank you for the opportunity to address the committee today. We appreciate being able to speak directly with you, and we understand the significance of this project for the people of the Highlands and Islands. And we wish to answer questions and address concerns voiced by the petitioners and others, including some of the members attending today. Fundamentally, this is a modernisation programme. It's a complex and challenging change management project. It is not something that HAIL has undertaken lightly. It is something that we have been considering for several years prior to the Helios report to address a structural deficit within worldwide air traffic control. We believe it must be done to ensure the long-term sustainability of air services in the Highlands and Islands. There is general agreement between our air traffic teams and the trade union representatives on the need for a modernisation programme. However, there are no alternative proposals for air traffic services that provide the all-encompassing solution of HAIL's current air traffic management strategy. Unless we modernise and move forward with it, we cannot guarantee air connectivity for the Highlands and Islands into the future. The Air Traffic Management Strategy aims to provide a foundation stone to address industry-wide structural deficits which, if left unaddressed, will compromise our lifeline activities and the airline customers that provide them. These structural deficits were detailed in our earlier submission to this committee last October and include aging operating models and infrastructure, the need to improve resilience, staff recruitment and retention, a changing legislative framework within UK and European aviation, and an opportunity to improve safety. Our modernisation programme seeks to address all of these issues, not least the resilience challenge, with the current pandemic only highlighting the fundamental fragility of the current model of operation. New technology and new ways of working are required if we are to remain capable of providing aviation services the country needs. Not for today, not for tomorrow, but for the next 15 to 25 years. So we must act now to modernise our operations. I'd like to offer a brief explanation of the journey we have been on and present our vision of our ultimate destination. In 2017, consultants Helios were commissioned to examine options for the future of air traffic management for HAIL. In January 2018, the HAIL board approved the Air Traffic Management Strategy programme and received approval from the then Transport Minister. Soon after, the Air Traffic Management Strategy programme board was established, the membership including Transport Scotland, a non-executive member of the HAIL board, and the full-time Prospect trade union officer up until only very recently. By July 2018, the consultancy group ECOS published the optimal location for the combined surveillance centre. They identified Inverness as the optimal location, and this decision was made in part following consultation with air traffic colleagues who expressed a preference that Inverness should be required to relocate. In December 2019, the air traffic management business case was approved by the Transport Scotland Investment and Decision Making Board. As recently as June 2020, a detailed review of the air traffic management strategy programme direction was undertaken by the new HIAL board, the previous board members having resigned, which the new board endorsed previous decisions. The project remains on schedule and on budget. While the focus of the programme remains on ensuring long-term connectivity for communities, it will also establish a centre of excellence for air traffic management in the Highlands and Islands and indeed Scotland, with the potential to provide training and expertise to airports across the world. We appreciate that a programme of this magnitude and complexity will bring significant change for people, not least our highly valued air traffic control colleagues, but we believe it must be done. From the outset, we have sought to be open, transparent and inclusive. We have asked for views, insight and input from our staff, the unions and the local community, and their contributions have been and will continue to be taken on board as we deliver air navigation services into the future. The Air Traffic Management Strategy Delivery Team has studied, consulted with and is learning from other countries and their air traffic systems to ensure that the technology we finally choose will be world class. To conclude, our project has safety, resilience and contingency built in. Our regulator would not permit us to do. Thank you for allowing us to address the committee today and looking forward to the discussion that follows.
Thank you very much for that and appreciate your opening statement. Can I maybe just confirm therefore that your position is that what you've decided is the only option?
It's the only option that delivers the level of resilience that we're seeking to introduce into the network as we look towards the next 15 to 25 years.
So while you're saying that you're working with other people and, you know, taking people's ideas on board, the basic point is that actually you take the view that this is really the only option that's available to you.
The option that delivers the resilience that we're looking for over the next 15 to 25 years is the option we've got on the table just now. And what we are doing is we're working with colleagues in the trade union, colleagues across the company, to find ways of helping these colleagues make that transition.
Okay. And just to clarify one other point for me, the petitioners have suggested that improving local infrastructure, including radar, would be a preferable option. And I understand that the Helios report dismissed radar in the tower as being unacceptable to the CAA, but in fact, it is acceptable to them. Is that right?
What I'm going to ask just now is I'm going to bring in Gary Cobb, because Gary will explain to you where we are in terms of surveillance technology. The subject of
I'll allow that in a moment, but it's just a basic point that the report by HIAL from Helios that dismissed radar in the tower has been unacceptable to the CAA. But the CAA, I understand, say that radar in the tower is a proven concept and is acceptable.
Radar in the tower is a concept that is used in airports where the traffic levels are low, and has been adopted by some of the larger airports in Scotland because the traffic levels are so low for the duration of the pandemic. Radar in the tower does not provide HIAL with a long-term solution to the risk that we face, because it involves adding resilience and adding manning levels to the towers, and where that resilience should be placed is in the centre.
Right, but it's not on a safety issue. It's not that you couldn't do that because CAA wouldn't approve it.
CAA would have to approve radar in the tower.
Yes, I understand that, but there's not a suggestion that they wouldn't approve it as an approach.
As a concept,
you chose not to do it for a different reason.
As a concept, the CAA will consider radar in the tower.
Okay, so did the report from Helios dismiss radar in the tower as being unacceptable to CAA?
I would need to revert back to the committee after.
Maybe that's something we can come back to us on that one. Can I also ask about, you did say that the project was on time, on budget. We've been informed that the costs of the ATMS are spiralling and that there are worrying similarities to the recent procurement of two Lifeline Island ferries. Can I ask, what's the expertise on the board in managing a project like this? Two things. Does the board have, you know, actual expertise around this area of work? And I don't know the membership of the board, but are there members of the board who live in remote and rural areas who might have a perspective on that other issue that obviously is playing into this?
Okay, if I can just paraphrase and repeat the question so that I'm clear. One is the costs and whether or not they're spiralling out of control. Two is the level of expertise, both on the board and presumably in the company. And then the third is where the members of the board live and where they reside and where they
Sorry, I think that probably sounds a bit harsh from my point of view. I'm interested in the budget and I'm also interested in the scale of expertise on the board because of, you'll understand, the anxieties around what's happened around Two Lifeline Island ferries. So it's reassurance around that we're looking for and addressing probably more fundamentally the question about the gap between you saying you're on time and on budget and being informed that the cost of the ATMS are spiralling.
Okay, it wasn't intended to be harsh, and so thank you for the clarity.
Likewise.
Costs just now are on budget, both the revenue costs and the capital costs. In the Helios report, Helios identified costs of approximately £28.4 million. And beside these costs, they listed what was included within the costs and what was excluded from these costs. We took a figure of £29.2 million to the Transport Scotland Investment Decision Board. And that on top of that, we had placed a contingency figure of £2.9 million. Following discussions at the Transport Scotland Investment Decision Board, that contingency was increased. And so the overall budget for the programme is at £34.7 million. So that's the original Helios amount plus a little over £5.5 million of contingency.
Okay, thank you very much. Can I call Maurice Corey, please?
The committee understands that the ATS primary surveillance equipment, which is radar, was not included as part of the original proposal for ATMS, however, has subsequently been added to comply with CA requirements. Was the primary surveillance included in the original plan? And if not, what were the additional costs associated with ATS primary surveillance equipment radar procurement and its subsequent ongoing running costs? Mr. Ingalls, a few.
The original Helios report did not include primary surveillance. The Helios report preferred to use new and emerging technology, something called ADS-B. The position of the CAA on ADS-B is likely to adopt ADS-B as a method of surveillance going forward. And ADS-B, when compared to primary surveillance, is markedly less expensive.
Right. Okay. Well, I understand, and thank you for that reply, Mr. Lyon. And as I say, good to see you coming before us today with your team. Can I therefore follow on and say, has this requirement and additional cost prompted any rethink at all in any way by the Hyle board?
The fact that we are looking at the alternative surveillance technology.
Yes.
Yes. No. The alternative surveillance technology dovetails with the kind of facility that we are intending to pursue and the kind of option that we are pursuing.
Right. So there's nothing in a sort of pipeline that's thrown up any queries by the board itself that you've brought to the board and presented to them as
no,
potential alternatives. Right. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Tom Mason.
Thank you, Convener. Welcome. You have a mission statement which says to create social benefit and economic prosperity by building Scotland's sustainable regional airport group of the future. Can you explain how the ATMS project will achieve this for remote and island communities?
The two parts to that. The first relates to what we set out as the strategy. And the strategy is to provide a foundation for continued air services throughout the Highlands and Islands, not just for the medium term, but for the long term. And if I can just perhaps give some background to the decision making so you understand why we've taken these decisions in context. As early as 2014, 2015, we were experiencing significant issues in providing our published opening hours. And in that year, 2014, we experienced over 170 occasions in Stornoway of being unable to provide our published opening hours. More recently, pre-COVID, we've experienced the same kind of issues, not necessarily in Stornoway, but elsewhere across the network. And therefore, by adopting this model that provides that level of resilience, by adopting this model that is based in the centre that allows us to layer in these different levels of resilience, means that we will be able to give assurance that air traffic control will be continuing throughout the Highlands and Islands over the medium to long term, and thus providing that foundation for continued air services. If we don't do that, then we cannot give that assurance to either our customers, the airlines that use us, or indeed to the passengers. So it's absolutely vital that we get into that position where we are able to deliver that level of resilience.
Thank you. Well, thank you for that. The committee has received evidence that demonstrates that the air traffic controller workforce in remote and island communities is stable. However, significant concerns have been raised about the instability in this workforce in Inverness, where all the efforts are now being concentrated. On this point, it seems that the ATMS runs counter to the Scottish Government's commitment to sustain island and remote communities, as well as potentially undermining resilience of the service in the future. What is your response to this?
Pre-COVID, our staff turnover levels in air traffic control were about 6%, just slightly under 5.9%, and that's twice the industry average. And so by adopting the new technology, by basing the facility under the one roof, we will be in a position to continue to attract and retain staff into that centre to provide that level of resilience going forward. And if we can move from turnover levels that are twice the industry average to turnover levels that are below the industry average, that puts us in a really decent place to be able to continue to deliver that level of connectivity.
We also understand that there is an Islands Impact Assessment Commission. What is the assessment? What does this assessment conclude? Have we got all the information?
Thank you for asking that. We have commissioned an Islands Impact Assessment. It's been undertaken by a local consultant independently of Highlands and Islands Airports. And that same consultant has worked for the Northern Isles, Shetland, Orkney, and the Western Isles. So he's what we call in the North a well-kent face. And he has produced a draft of that report. The final report is now landed on my desk, and that will be taken to the board on February the 24th. And following board consideration on the 24th, the intention is that that is published.
Thank you.
Finished, Tom? Can I just follow up on that very briefly, just to confirm that an Islands Impact Assessment would be looking at impact on jobs in a local community, where perhaps this kind of work creates a hub, it generates more jobs round about it, and makes the actual islands themselves more stabilised in terms of employment opportunities?
The island impact assessment, I'm speaking from memory now in terms of the scope, and the scope was formed after discussions with the islands team, is to identify areas where a particular policy could have an impact different on an island community, different to a mainland community, and to identify appropriate mitigations where it's possible to do so. So that's what the island impact assessment will pull out. And as I say, the session that follows today is to go through that island impact assessment.
So it would look at the impact of your proposal, as opposed to looking at it from the point of view, how do we generate more employment? I mean, you're a wholly owned subsidiary of the Scottish Government, I understand. So if they had a policy which says we want to encourage high quality skilled jobs in remote and rural areas, your proposal would it be looked at from that side rather than the other way around?
It will look at the impact on the community. Without having read the draft that's currently sitting in the inbox, I couldn't answer the rest of the question. I need to come back to you on that.
Has that been factored in by the board in its original discussions about options? Because if you're looking at the original option around this, looks to me like a centralising proposal, even though it's centralised within the Highlands. Would there have been a discussion at that stage around the impact on remote areas of work being centralised in Inverness?
There was a discussion around that, and that was one of the reasons why the island impact assessment has been commissioned to identify some of the mitigations that we can pull into this.
Okay, thanks very much. Jill Ross.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, panel. Going back to Ingalls, in your submission you dispute that Highall has not engaged sufficiently with staff, stating that not agreeing is not the same as not engaging. However, we've received several submissions from experienced staff, I must say, who feel that their concerns are being ignored, but they've had to put them in anonymously because they fear disciplinary action. So what do you think, in your opinion, this says about your engagement with staff and how they're feeling at the moment?
I'm very happy to come back to the committee and provide the dates when meetings have been held with staff, some meetings with the board, some meetings individually, where our staff have been forthright and honest and frank in their opinions as to what we are doing and what we are doing right and what we're doing wrong. So I'm satisfied that our teams feel able to communicate with the company as and when they feel. And I've seen some of the correspondence that's not been addressed to me, that's been addressed to others. So I am aware that our communication channels are open. It's the first point I would make. The second point I would make around the actual comms, people have said, we've told you that, you know, you're doing the wrong thing, you're going down the wrong path. But if you are to continue with this, here are some of the things that we would like you to consider. So say, for example, relocation. We had discussions initially, very early discussions with the team about relocation. And the team said to us, if that's the relocation policy, I can promise you nobody will come, because you're not looking at this thing in the round. And so what we have to do is we have to put a relocation policy in place that says to folk that are intending to relocate from the island communities to the centre, that it will be as trouble-free and as all-encompassing as is practically possible. I should not have to worry about a single thing. That policy in draft is now with the trade union. I went there last week. Others said to us when we went out and spoke very early days, are you going to allow commuting? And we say, okay, commuting's a really good idea. Let's see how we can make commuting work. Let's talk about commuting. So again, in consultation with the teams, we have arrived at that commuting policy. And again, what sits behind that commuting policy is, if I'm being asked to commute, to travel back and forth to work, it needs to be absolutely as trouble-free as is practically possible. And I hope that that's the policy that's now, again, with the trade unions. And then we're going to find folk that don't want to move from the islands, folk that want to stay there. And what we have to do is to ensure that we treat these folk, these highly valued colleagues, exactly the same as those who will be relocating, exactly the same as those who will be commuting. And these are discussions that we will have with these individuals once we have identified those who are going to relocate and those who are going to commute. And then just to finish on the point of taking taking notice of what folks say, when two of the senior members of the team went out to brief the Bimbecula team, they came back with a suggestion. And the suggestion was, okay, we will now have more airports operating AFIS operations as opposed to ATCO operations. Is there the potential to create a centre on Bimbecula? And so that's what we intend to deliver. So you will in effect have two training centres, one for the ATCO people in Inverness and one for the AFIS people on Bimbecula, a centre of excellence for training on Bimbecula. I'm very happy Pat Nolan, who's running that project, is on the call, and he will speak to that if you want him to.
Yes, I would like to hear about that, Pat.
Sorry. So just to expand on the point Ingalls has made on the Aerodrome Flight Information Officer Centre of Excellence at Bimbecula. That project is running concurrent with the project to transition the service from ATC to AFIS at Bimbecula. It started in August last year, and it's due to conclude in April next year. When the Centre of Excellence is opened, what it will do is it will create a hub, effectively, for management and coordination of the AFIS service across what will be six AFIS airports. So the four existing AFIS airports, plus Bimbecula and Wick. So we will create two new full-time management level positions there. An AFIS manager for the AFIS function across the company will be based there, and an AFIS training manager will be based there to manage the activities of the AFIS centre. So from the AFIS centre, we will deliver all of the training and development requirements for the company's circa 50 flight information officers. We will deliver all the maintenance of competency across the six AFIS airports, and all safety-related activities will be centred there as well. For instance, safety auditing, compliance, maintenance of competency, as I was saying, occurrence investigation, and that type of activity. We envisage that when the centre opens next year, April 22, that within, we'll say, 3 months of the centre opening, we'll be in a position to deliver our first in-house flight information officers training course. And that will be a comprehensive high standard course that will meet both our needs and the needs indeed of anybody else from outside the company, any third party that wanted to access that training going forward in the future. That's kind of just an overall summary, and I'm glad to take any questions on that.
And do you have any projected numbers about how many people will be going through this training centre? And obviously, if we've got six airports in Scotland that use this technology, you know, you did say about airports outside Scotland, but I would imagine that the turnover of FISO operators is not going to be huge. So therefore, are you going to have enough numbers to keep this training centre going?
So in-house, we will have, it's not just about training, as I was saying, it's about the delivery training and the maintenance of competency, which is a task within itself across the six airports and involves every single FISO and every single Met observer out there. And it also includes all of the safety oversight and safety activities. But just getting back to the question about, I suppose, the throughput for a FISO courses themselves, there are several sizable AFIS airports within the UK, some of them operating, a sizable number of them operating in excess of 30,000 movements a year. There is only one training provider in the UK, which is Global ATS, that provides an FISO training course. That's down south in Cheltenham. We will be the only organisation providing a comparative course north of the border. And not alone that, but our training centre is based on an airport, which brings its own advantages. So it's not just classroom training, but there's the opportunity to provide students with enhanced familiarisation of the AFIS environment, the live AFIS environment, which Global can't do at the moment. So we think going forward, as we develop the course, we develop the simulation package to match the course, and we refine it, we start delivering it to our own people initially, that the course will become a quite marketable product going forward.
And how long does it take to train an operative?
So the course we currently avail of is the Global Air Traffic Service course in Cheltenham. And that is a 3-week course, followed by a 2-week Met Observers course. Now, we wouldn't be aiming to deliver the exact course. We would be aiming to take the model of that course and review it in accordance with our own requirements and how we see AFIS developing across the industry. So our course will probably be somewhere, it will be longer, I can guarantee you it will be longer, because we'll be adding an additional element of simulation to it. So our course going forward, and again, we're going through the process of course design at the moment. So we're thinking somewhere around a 5-week course plus a 2-week Met Observers course, which will be delivered in a Met training providers.
And will accommodation be provided for the training operatives as well?
Well, I suppose that's where we're looking. As I said, we have 50 advisors within the company. We train up roughly 8 to 9 new advisors every year. Those 50 advisors going forward, not in year one, but in year two, we will start bringing in refresher training for FISOs, which is a beyond compliance requirement. It's not a requirement for FISOs, but we want to start developing our FISOs. So the footfall on the island will we increase significantly in any event, even without third parties availing of the course. We haven't got an exact footfall on that yet, but that's something we will be working on as we go through. From the point of view of people will, of course, be staying over on the island. That will mean there will be a demand for accommodation, rental cars, catering, and any social events you're involved in. The Centre of Excellence will also be used going forward for other HIL events, such as board meetings, a FISO annual general meetings. We might offer to host something like the UK FISO Association annual general meeting there. So, you know, there will be an increased footfall due to the Centre of Excellence and its activities.
Okay, and if you'll indulge me, Convener, just one last question on this topic. It would be remiss of me to let this go without asking, and it's nothing against Benbecula. Why Benbecula and not Wick for the Centre of Excellence?
And first of all, I think it's the most obvious one that we currently have 4 AFIS airports clustered on the Western Isles. When Bekele comes online, we will have 5 AFIS airports clustered on the Western Isles. Wick is the one that is geographically, I suppose, located at somewhat of a distance. So therefore, from a business point of view, it makes more sense to centre the hub where the cluster of airports are. In other words, we've got 5 airports. Now, that is not to say that Wick will not be centrally involved in the Centre of Excellence, because going forward, the model that we are going to have at both Benbecula and Wick Airport is quite different to the model we have at our existing 4 AFIS airports, because the airports will retain their full suite of instrument approach services, their full suite of air traffic control systems, including full voice communication systems, semi-automatic weather systems, automated flight information systems, etc. I don't want to bore you on it, but they will also be staffed by a full-time team of advisors with a dedicated unit manager. So they will have an enhanced skill set insofar as the advisors at Benbecula and the advisors at Wick are the ones who will effectively be the instructors and the competency assessors operating from the new centre, which means that the new centre will be calling on the resource at Wick which will provide an ideal opportunity for the new advisors at Wake to effectively develop themselves into that area of trainers, competency assessors, investigators, auditors. So Wake will be effectively centrally involved. So you can expect to see some of the staff from Wake as required from time to time, supplementing the staff at Benbecula in the new Centre of Excellence.
Okay, thank you. That's all from me just now, Convener. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to witnesses. You have previously outlined a summary of detailed programmes of studies, reviews and independent approvals undertaken since December 2017. You have also highlighted that the Scottish Government's Internal Audit and Assurance Directorate was due to provide a further independent review and an objective health check on the programme in January 2021. Can you provide an update on this work, please?
Yes, I can. We received the report yesterday, and that report will go forward to the board again on February 24th. I'd rather let the board hear firsthand, but yes, we've received that report. I'm happy to discuss that or provide the committee with feedback afterwards.
Concerns have been repeatedly raised about the resilience of communications infrastructure underpinning the project. Petitioners state that not even how commissioned reports give firm assurances that robust enough communications exist, nor indicate how much it would cost to install links to comply with the CAA safety requirements. Given how critical communications are to the success of the ATMS, can you outline what enhancements are required to the infrastructure and how will these be delivered as part of the project?
If I may, Convener, I'll ask Gary Cobb to pick up on that. Gary's dealing with the communications infrastructure part of the project in addition to running the project in the round.
Okay, that's fine. Thank you.
Okay, so in answer to that question, as you said, the CAA as the regulator have requirements that we have to hit as HAIL in order to hit communication. In the remote, and what they normally ask for is three connections or three routes that you can have. Aiming to hit the protect the final mile, we can hit those three routes. And then in terms of routes off the island, there's two, north and south, depending on which island or which location you're talking about. In terms of the cost of what this looks like, we're currently doing a proof of concept in Sumbra, and that will inform some of the costs. So it's a little bit early to say what the exact cost will be, but all indications that we're getting at the moment is that we'll fall within the budget that we've set for it, with more detailed work happening this year, which will confirm those costs. On top of that, we're still going through the down selection of who the provider of the remote tower technology will be. So we're down to four and we're getting that down to one. And again, some of the requirements from that will come from which of those four is successful in that tender, because that will drive some of the requirements. But at the moment, everything that we're seeing is that we can do it for the budget that we set.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. Gail Ross?
Oh, there we are. That's me. Thanks, Convener. So to go back to the WEC and Benbecula airport, it's been suggested that changing the current system to FISO would lead to less flexible provision of air traffic services, and they'll no longer be able to deal with several aircraft simultaneously. Now, I know that in recent months and since we lost the two commercial routes, we've had very few aircraft coming in and out of WEC Airport, but as you know, Ingalls, we do emergency flights for the NHS. We've got oil traffic. We've got the helicopters for the offshore wind. So what's your view of that that statement that we'll no longer be able to deal with the several aircraft simultaneously?
The intention is that we will have no impact. The changes will have no impact on our ability to manage current levels of traffic or potentially even further growth. And to give you an example, Sywell Aerodrome in Northamptonshire handles 30,000 movements per annum. Barton Airfield in Greater Manchester, I think, is up closer to 50,000 movements per annum. But I wonder, could I just bring Patrick in just for 5 minutes, just to talk through how we would operate these aerodromes, because it's important that you hear this part from the expert.
Yes, I'll just pick up on that. Thank you, Ingles. You've just given the example of two or three airports down south that handle considerably more movements than either Benbecula or Wick, quite safely and efficiently. So just to come back to the question, which centred on Benbecula, traditionally Benbecula handles less than 4,000 aircraft movements per annum, of which a significant number are actually not scheduled flights. So generally speaking, the existing flight schedule is deconflicted almost by default by the fact there is not a lot of, as you know, I won't say a lot of not, a lot, sorry, I'm getting tongue to myself here, but what I'm trying to say is that there are not a large number of scheduled flights on a daily basis, so they are almost deconflicted by default. That said, there are certain occasions when flights can conflict by their concurrent nature. In other words, when flights are running late or running early, or flights flying under an instrument flight rules flight plan request to use the airport on a non-scheduled basis. Our intention is to introduce a range of additional mitigations at both airports, including the introduction of a slot allocation system currently used at our other AFIS airports, which will ensure that scheduled flights and other non-scheduled flights are deconflicted by means of scheduling. We will work with Loganair, who, as you know, our main operator at Benbecula, and indeed the other stakeholders, including the emergency services, Bristow's and Gamma, at both airports, and at the local operators, to ensure the scheduled flights will be deconflicted through agreeing scheduling in conjunction with the slot allocation system. Based on the current projected schedule, and the projected schedule, neither HIAL, Loganair, nor indeed the emergency services envisage that the introduction of a slot allocation system at both airports will have any meaningful impact on scheduled flights. For example, and I will just wind up with this one, if the slot allocation system that we're using for scheduled flights at our existing four airports was introduced to Benbecula in the morning, we would have circa 57 slots per week for aircraft operating under IFR, so aircraft flying on an IFR flight plan, which includes the likes of scheduled flights and large charter flights. There would be effectively be no impact if we introduced that in the morning, because based on the 2019 figures at the airport, when we were running on normal figures pre-COVID, only 22 of the 57 available slots was used. So that means in the morning, if we were to introduce that system, we would still have 60% capacity on it to facilitate either additional scheduled flights or non-scheduled flights. Furthermore, the intention is to install a surveillance-based flight information display system at both airports, which will provide the new AFISO team with enhanced situational awareness, thereby providing the ability to provide more prompt and accurate traffic information. So I think when you wind that all up, I'll just summarise by saying, right now we don't envisage that there will be any meaningful impact on scheduled flights at either airport.
So just a follow-up question to that then. Before the Loganair flight from Edinburgh to Wick was pulled, I used it every week to get down to Parliament. And it's no small feat by the staff at Wick Airport that there were very little weather delays in winter time, when you think that that would be the time that they would happen. It's more in the summer when we get the haar coming in from the sea. How would slot times be affected if the pilot was waiting for a weather window, as happened quite often from Wick?
Well, I think I could start by saying the decision as to whether to conduct a flight in poor or marginal weather conditions effectively rests with the airport operator, their operating procedures, and on a more tactical basis, the pilot themselves, and that's on all occasions. And it's not really influenced by whether the air traffic service at an airport is an ATC service or a flight information service. However, what is important is the type of instrument approach at the airport and the minimum descent altitude for that particular approach in association with the airport's low visibility procedures. So going forward, our expectation is that both airports, including WIC, will retain their full suite of instrument approach services and operate their in-house low visibility procedures. Therefore, we don't really envisage that the delays that will be naturally incurred by poor weather will change in any way, whether it's an ATC or an AFIS service.
But I'm talking about slot times. If the plane is due to go at, say, 10 o'clock in the morning and the weather's forecast to clear at 2 o'clock, but that 2 o'clock slot is being taken up by another service coming in or going out, how does that work?
Sorry, I misunderstood your question. I do apologise. At WIC, the new Airdrome Flight Information Service will provide a service out to circa 10, 12, 15 miles. Outside of that, a new joint radar sector for Kirkwall and WIC will be introduced. And that radar service will be provided from the new combined centre in Inverness. So you will have a level of flexibility at WIC that you might not have at some other airports, insofar as that radar service can effectively sequence traffic, and particularly this comes into its own in poor weather conditions, and hold traffic, and they will continue to be in receipt of a radar service until such time as the weather is suitable for them to effectively shoot an approach to the airport. So you've got a lot of additional facilities in WIC, because right now, as you know, WIC is a procedural-only air traffic control unit. Going forward, while the airport itself will change from air traffic control to AFIS, the actual environment immediately around that airport will go from a procedural service to a radar service, which brings on board huge advantages from the point of view of safety, flexibility, efficiency, etc.
So is it a possibility or is it not a possibility that the slot times will lead to delays or cancellations, or will it improve the service, which would mean less delays or cancellations than we've seen before?
I'll answer that by saying that, by coming back to the, I suppose, the first point, that, you know, the decision on whether to land or depart at an airport in poor weather comes down to an operator pilot decision. And then I think I'll just caveat that by saying that, of course, the normal delays incurred by weather will not be decreased by the introduction of an AFIS service, but neither do I think they will be increased by the introduction of an AFIS service. Because while there is a slot allocation system, as I said to you, there's a lot of flexibility and capacity within that system to facilitate aircraft that may be running late or may have to reschedule. So I'm sorry for going around in a circle on it, but I don't think you'll see a significant difference.
Could I maybe ask Gary what his take on that is, convener? Because I believe that there was a meeting before when he was asked the same question.
Yeah, so happy to. My view is the same as Pat's. My experiences previously to Heil came from Gatwick. What you find with all of the large airports in the UK is that they all have slots. The big UK airports are slotted, so I'm well used to working with slots and the flexibility that slots have. I believe that there's enough capacity in the system, as Pat says, that slots won't have any impact. in terms of the flexibility that we'll see at Benbecca or WIC. And I think weather delays will be weather delays, but a change of service from ATC to AFIS won't have any impact on that.
Okay, and Convener, I've got one last question about approved operators. Can somebody explain to me how approved operators work, how you become one, and how that might impact, subway traffic that we get in WIC, they come in to refuel and get various other services, and if they're not an approved operator, how would that work? Ingalls?
Gary, could you pick that up, please?
Gary?
I'll probably pass this one to Pat, because Pat's got quite a lot of experience of talking to the approved operators. But my view of approved operators is that approved operators is we have control over who becomes an approved operator. Pat, do you want to expand upon that?
Yeah, I'll just pick up briefly. The concept of approved operators came into being when the four existing AFIS airports on the Western Isles came into being, because they were unique insofar as they had scheduled traffic and they had instrument approach procedures. So we had to put additional safeguards in place at that stage to support the overall safety case. And one of those safeguards mitigations was that only approved operators would use the instrument approaches. I think we have proved now over the last two decades that those services run very safely and very efficiently with very, very little cases of incidents. So therefore, we are currently in the process of removing the requirement for approved operator status, because we don't really feel it's fit for purpose any longer. So in answer to your question, and we did brief the Far North Aviation on this quite recently. In the coming months, we see ourselves effectively removing the requirement for approved operators.
Okay, thanks, Pat. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you.
Thank you. Can I now call Rhoda Grant, and I'll call Liam MacArthur after Rhoda.
Thank you, Convener. Many of the questions I had have been asked, but I've got follow-ups on a number of them. So if you don't mind, if I just move about between different subject areas. At the very start, we were told that the reason that direct surveillance radar in the tower was not looked at as an option because that required manning the towers. So can I just get confirmation that from the very start, this was a project to centralise air traffic control?
This was not a project to centralise air traffic control. Helios were asked to undertake an independent assessment of the options that were available, and they've put forward the option of locating the centre, of building the centre, and that centre allows us to layer the levels of resilience. To give you a for example, if you have a control tower with, let's say, for example, six people controlling traffic on a seven-day-a-week basis, it carries with it a level of resilience, but that level of resilience is particularly low. If you have individuals in a facility who are trained to manage two airports, you start to layer up that level of resilience. So say, for example, you could find an individual controlling traffic, for example, at Inverness on a Monday and a Tuesday, and then being able to control traffic at Kirkwall, for example, on a Wednesday and a Thursday and a Friday. And by building in that level of resilience, you help manage staff recruitment and retention issues, you help manage staff sickness issues, and you build in a level of resilience that doesn't currently exist in the network, is the first thing. The second thing, and linked with that, is what comes with the centre, because the centre will function in and of itself. But to provide that level of resilience, there will also be a contingency centre, which will be a small building, but will allow the centre to facilitate continue operations in the event that something goes wrong at the centre. And then the third level of resilience, and this is what we're talking about here, resilience, is the requirement for us to have redundancy built into the system. So, for example, in the event that one of the feeds fails, there is a backup. And in the event that that backup fails, there is a further backup. So it is about layering in that level of resilience right across the network.
How many backups technology? How many backups are available at each of the airports involved? My understanding is there is one.
Okay,
and there should be four.
Sorry, there is no, the CAA have set no minimum quantity for backups. What the CAA will be provided with is a safety case that sets out our rationale for how we provide these backups. And Gary, I'm looking at you and just asking, is there anything that you want to add here?
Yeah, and I suppose I'll just ask for a clarification of the question of which backups did you mean?
For communications, so you need to be able to communicate to the remote towers. My understanding is that you should have four backups available if your primary communication route fails.
Currently or in the future with the remote tower? Going forward with the remote... Sorry, so in terms of going... Yeah, and so by putting in this technology, we have additional fail-safes that become available to us. I think, as I mentioned in the answer before, in terms of communication, we have options on, for example, USUMBRA. You'd have a fibre that would go to an exchange. We then have options of looking at fibre radio link to different exchanges, and then we have options of copper wires. So we would look to mimic that across all of the different locations. Then in terms of subsea, again, there's multiple routes available, even if it does involve going through into Northern Europe and then back around. The technology exists, and we see that with some of the other remote towers that we see in industry at the moment. So in terms of the backups and the safeguards, this all forms part of the safety case. And I think there seems to be a misconception that what we're doing is massively cutting edge. It's blazing a trail that this isn't done. The regulatory framework for remote towers has existed within Europe since 2015. And Europe was, through EASA, the governing body for safety for the UK. In terms of in the UK, you only have to have a look at London City, which is almost due to come online. In terms of complexity, it's an extremely complex aerodrome. In terms of capacity, 5 million passengers. And in terms of the airspace above it, it is the most complex airspace in the world. There's no busier TMA than the London TMA. So in terms of intensity and the backups required, the regulatory framework for that exists, and we can conform to. And again, having part of this is the safety case, we'll be having a look at the technology. And I probably refer everybody through to the paragraph 3 of the CAA's response, which is, to date, the CAA have no major safety concerns. We've involved the CAA quite a lot. We'll involve the CAA quite a lot. And they are the ultimate arbiter of safety. Connectivity, cybersecurity, all of that fall within the CAA's remit. And we have lots of detailed conversations. And at the moment, they're not seeing anything.
Can I just cut you off? Because that's interesting, but it's not really answering my question. And my question is, are there going to be other hardwired? So are you going to lay subsea cables to allow the resilience in the system for communication?
No, I don't believe so. There's no plans to lay subsea cables.
Okay, so basically each airport will be dependent on the main connection that's in place at the moment. So if that fails...
No, I believe there's multiple connections. I believe there are multiple connections off, for example, Sumbra. So you can go through to Northern Europe, or you can go south through down to the mainland. The Western Isles, I'd have to get back to you on the details of that one, but I believe there are multiple options available again through the Western Isles. But I don't have the exact details to hand, so if possible, I can get back to you on that point.
That would be good to let the committee know for each of the airports, yep. Whether that's available or not. Can I just then turn to the finances? Ingalls, you said that the initial cost was 28.4 and because of contingencies, that's gone up to 34.7. My understanding is the original cost was 18 million.
That's not my understanding. The original, if you go to the Helios report, it's 28.4.
Okay, but before the Helios report, 18.
That's not something I'm familiar with, Rhoda. I'll need to come back to you on that. I don't know where the figures come.
Thank you. You talked about ADSB and that being included in the cost. If the CAA don't sign that off and ask for primary surveillance, what will be the additional cost?
Without going to tender, it would be guessing, but the cost would increase if the ADSB is not adopted.
By how much, roughly?
As I say, without going to tender, I wouldn't like to speculate, but the cost could increase if ADSB is not adopted as a technology. But that's not our understanding of where things might end up.
Okay. Turning to staffing, which seems to be the reason for centralisation, you talked about a 95% turnover in air traffic controllers. But then when Pat Nolan was talking about the FISOs, he said there was 55 FISOs and about 8 to 9 were required to be recruited and trained a year. That to me is an 18% turnover in FISOs. So that's quite a bit larger than the 6% in air traffic controllers.
The FISO complement is made up of two categories. Some accommodate FISO operations within other jobs. For example, we have firefighters who are FISOs. Sometimes they maintain their firefighting competency in addition to their FISO competency. And sometimes we have FISOs who are full-time, and people do tend to pick and choose their times for dropping in and out of their FISO ticket, if I said it like that.
Okay, but there is much
bigger
turnover.
You're not comparing like with like, whereas ATCOs provide a full-time role. That is their full-time role. For a FISO, for example, who's currently a fireman on Kirkwall or wherever else, he may undertake that FISO duties until it becomes onerous for him or her, and then he will drop that FISO part of it, which means that we then go out and find somebody else to take over that FISO part of it. So it's not quite apples and oranges, but it's not the same.
Okay. You talked about the turnover of staff, and you probably don't have this on you at the moment, but is it possible to get the staff turnover for the last 5 years per airport?
I can do, yes.
Yeah, and I wouldn't expect you to have that in your pocket at the moment. We understand from the unions that only 5% of staff are willing to relocate. So can I ask how they will be redeployed, how they will be their replacements will be recruited, and what work will they do, given there's a no redundancy policy if they don't move?
Thanks for that. From the outset, we've recognised that this is not a technology project, but a change management project in a fantastically complex operating environment. And similarly, from the outset, we've said to folk that some of you will have to relocate to the centre in Inverness, because unless we build this resilient operation in Inverness, we will have our ability to provide air traffic services in what is one of Scotland's essential pieces of transport infrastructure that will be compromised. To get to that point, we have to have some folk relocate. To get to that point, we have to have some folk commute. to get to that point, we will have to recruit more folk, and we will have some folk who decide to stay on the islands. Now, for these folk, just with everybody else that we employ in this organisation, we will do everything practicable within our powers to help these folk find the right solution. Now, these are discussions that we'll take once we've concluded discussions on the relocation policy, once we've concluded discussions on the commuting policy. We then move into having these discussions with these folk between them and their trade union representatives. But first of all, we have to understand the numbers that are involved. Now, here, the number that you've quoted is 5%. Understanding is that it's a little bit more than that, but first and foremost, we need to find out how many are going to relocate, how many are going to commute, and then we can start the discussions with those who are going to stay where they are, so as we can find the most appropriate solution for them.
Okay. That seems huge risk that it's coming over the hill. If only 5% wish to move, even if you double that, that seems risky to me. Can I turn to the island's impact assessment? A number of staff have told me that they have been told, regardless of the outcome of the island's impact assessment, this is going to continue, that it will make no difference. Can you tell me what difference the island's impact assessment could make?
I haven't read the island's impact assessment yet. That's, as I say, that's a job for later today. And then it's a job for the board to discuss at its meeting on the 24th. But so that we're all on the same page on this one, the island's impact assessment is independent. The scope of the island's impact assessment has been developed, having had discussions with the island's team. It was done that way because the detailed guidance on how to carry out an island's impact assessment, I don't think, has only just finished its consultation in terms of how it should be carried out. So unfortunately, that wasn't available at the time. So the document that will land, hopefully in your inbox, post the board meeting on the 24th, will identify the mitigations that the consultant involved has put forward. So I'm confident that the island's impact assessment will do exactly as it's intended to do within the scope of the Islands Act.
Okay, can I just ask, sorry, convener, but just a few questions on the downgrading of Benbecula and Wick. Gail Ross had asked a number, but can I ask what are the cost savings to this programme, if because Benbecula and Wick have been downgraded, what would be the programme costs and the running costs to this new scheme if they remained as was?
Okay, the first thing to say is that Highlands and Islands Airports controls traffic in two ways: air traffic controllers and airport flight information services. At Benbecula, they practice both air traffic control and airport flight information services. The proposal is to extend the period of time during which airport flight information is practiced, is the first thing. The second thing is, in terms of staffing numbers, Pat has explained to you that providing the centre goes ahead in Benbecula, there will be a net increase in staff numbers there of approximately 2 individuals. So there will not be a cost saving in revenue as a result of introducing that centre on Benbecula.
But the capital costs, sorry, I asked for
cost, the intention is to invest in facilities there, in building and in simulators, and that will more or less match what would have occurred under the air traffic management strategy.
Okay. Staff have told me that since the decision was made to downgrade Benbecula, that they have been on more than one occasion requested information that they can only describe as retrospective information regarding the operation of Benbecula and staff. Seems to me that the whole picture was not in place when this decision was made. Is that correct?
I couldn't say, Rhoda, I don't know what information you have in front of you.
Okay. Staff are saying they were asked for information that they believe should have been taken into account making the decision after the decision was made.
The decision was taken, and when Gary Cobb, who's the other chap on the call, was appointed to the position of Chief Operating Officer, Gary was dispatched by the board to Benbecula to carry out a cold case review of the decision that we've taken. So Gary was there to independently, if you like, assess the decision that was taken. And Gary, I'm happy that Gary speak for himself, but Gary came back and confirmed that the decision was the appropriate decision to move from air traffic control to extending the hours of APHIS operations.
Okay. And can I just
It was just, and I was quite lucky. So when I came in, the board gave me free rein to go in and have a look at the decision that had been made on Benbecula. People have said that there's no engagement. The staff at Benbecula said that they were unhappy. I went out to meet them. I listened to all of their concerns. I had a look at the case that had been built for a service change at Benbecula, and then listened to all of the concerns that were against it. I then went away, had a look at the facts, and basically a lot of what I found is you can probably find in the CAA's response, which is it's low complexity, low density airspace, and it's an extension of service, and it won't have any material impact on safety, and that an APHIS airport is an appropriate level of surface for Benbecula. So in terms of engagement, we had lots of engagement, we did it. In terms of the data that's being asked for, in building a safety case, what you have to do is it's an extremely comprehensive document that goes into a lot of things that have happened in the past, lots of decisions and lots of situations and scenarios. Some of the information that's being asked for is more in helping provide evidence for a safety case, whether a mitigation is needed or not. It's not to be involved in any of the decision making per se. It's mainly in the evidence that would be built up around a safety case. And that's pretty common. You'd be looking back, scanning back for potentially 5-10 years just to have a look at scenarios and situations that have occurred.
I'm assuming that you would have looked at the kinetic operation there with the MOD and with NATO. What impact will this have on their operations and using the airfield?
So the danger zone has a just adds a slight complexity to Benbecula. However, at the moment, Benbecula doesn't have surveillance. So a lot of the control of those aircraft is done by the kinetic range, probably the NATS controllers that do the kinetic range. And the communication, whilst done through our air traffic controllers, is initiated through surveillance that's picked up through kinetic. A lot of this is we're in discussions with kinetic to find a mitigation for how this could be done. But again, in conversations that we've had, this isn't something that we foresee being a problem for us to be able to resolve.
So you've made the decision, and yet one of the biggest employers, biggest operators in the area is still in consultation with how you mitigate the impact of that decision?
No, what I said is we're in conversation with them in terms of the safety case for some of the procedures and the protocols that you would have when the danger zone is activated and deactivated. In terms of the going ahead, Kinetic were consulted with at the very start, and continuous consultation is ongoing with Kinetic to discuss what options are available and how we can do this and how the safety case is built. Safety cases, when built, are can be multi-agency and need to involve all parties involved. So Kinetic will be built into the safety case, which is why consultation is still ongoing. And there are many different routes and answers to how you do it. And what we'll do is find the best, the optimum, and the safest.
Okay. And with regard to the downgrading of WIC, a couple of years ago, WIC was incredibly busy with oil traffic because helicopters couldn't fly out of Aberdeen. They all needed to move to WIC. If that were to happen again, would WIC be able to cope?
I'll refer back. Oh, sorry, Ingalls. Yep, you carry on.
Yes, WIC will be able to cope. And I think that slightly with the scope of this committee, WIC has an amazing opportunity in front of it in terms of the money that's been put there by the Scottish Government for the PSO, and with good partnership working between the Highland Council, the NDA, Scottish Government, I think WIC has a fantastic future. It really does. But we all need to work together on that one to get that one over the line.
Okay, thank you, Convener.
Thanks, Rhoda, thank you for that. I'll call Liam MacArthur.
Thanks, Convener. I'm very conscious, a little like Rhoda, that a lot of the areas that I want to cover have been covered. So what I'll try to do is approach them in a slightly different way, taking into account what Ingalls and colleagues have said. Good morning to the panel. Let me start in relation to the island impact assessment. Rhoda's made the point that there is grave concern, certainly in my own Orkney constituency, that this is an exercise in going through the motions, that little will change as a result of it. Almost irrespective, Ingalls, of what this impact assessment says, the fundamental fact is that the board has given sign-off to a project that is going to strip these roles, strip these jobs out of the islands, and that no amount of retrospective island impact assessments is going to change that. So in a sense, this, I have to say, brings the whole process of island proofing and island impact assessments into disrepute. Now, how would you respond to those concerns?
The genesis for the discussion today was a series of circumstances that took place over a number of years, culminating in a very poor performance at Stornoway in 2014. And then from there, a number of discussions culminating in the appointment of Helios to produce that independent report, which we have adopted, and we're now pursuing this centre in Inverness. From the outset, we've been clear with most folk during the consultation period that it will involve the relocation of some of these jobs to the island, to the centre. And failing to do that, failing to build in that level of resilience, failing to layer these different levels of resilience and looking at the project over the medium to long term, means that we will not be able to provide that level of air traffic control, means that we will not be able to provide that foundation for air traffic control, means that we cannot give an assurance on air traffic control. So regardless of all of the good work that we're doing up there in Orkney just now, which you're aware of through the sustainable aviation test environment, regardless all of the good work that we do with airlines to encourage them to use larger planes, use them more frequency, and all of these different things, they come to naught if I don't have, if the company doesn't have, air traffic controllers to manage that traffic. So this is very much about future-proofing this essential piece of transport infrastructure to, from, and within the Highlands and Islands, and from there, being able to give operators and passengers the assurance that things will continue to fly.
Your reference there to the recruitment and retention issues being the driver for the project is obviously one that you've returned to on a regular basis in the discussions that we've had. The truth is that while there were certainly retention issues at Stornoway Airport for a period, the biggest area of concern in terms of recruitment and retention at the moment is Inverness, which is where you're looking to relocate and centralise these services, and where there has been local recruitment undertaken by HIAL in the past, it has proved enormously successful, and yet it is downplayed in the evidence produced by HIAL, notably in the ECOS report, as a footnote. The recruitment and retention that has been on the back of that programme exemplifies what HIAL should have been continuing to do over recent years, and would have then been able to address the challenging issues that I don't doubt that you, like many other employers in the Highlands and Islands, face. But to centralise these roles to Inverness is going to, I think, give rise two different but equally significant recruitment and retention problems, as we're already seeing in Inverness.
In my opening remarks, I spoke about how the pandemic has highlighted the fragility of some of the current practices. And that recruitment part is a very, very good example, and Inverness is a good example of it. At the moment, on paper, we have sufficient bodies in that control tower, but seven of them are trainees, and we cannot get sufficient airspace to get them trained because of the pandemic over the last year, and we cannot get them close enough to controllers to carry out their controlling duties. And this is not something that's exceptional to Highlands and Islands airports. This is something that's happening right across industry just now. So when the new centre is built, it will be designed in such a way as to ensure that we are in a position, hopefully, God forbid that we ever go through this again, but if we do, then we are in that position to maintain that training for these trainees. So the pandemic has highlighted just how fragile this current model is.
But okay, the pandemic is being cited as the justification for doing all manner of things or not doing all manner of things at the moment. But actually, the issues in terms of recruitment and retention at Inverness predate the start of the pandemic. But turning to that pandemic, what assessment or reassessment of this of these proposals has been undertaken as a result of this? You started in your opening remarks suggesting that this is a project on schedule and on budget. But as we've already heard, there has been an increase, to your mind, from 28.4 million to 34.7 million, an increase of over 22%. In discussions I had with Ross McAllister, who was taking forward a due diligence on this programme, he was talking in terms of figures of 18 to 20 million referred to by Rhoda Grant, which would represent a 75 to 90% increase in the budget. So I'm not entirely sure how this constitutes being on schedule, on budget. We've seen a requirement in terms of primary radar. We're seeing an indication that additional communication links are going to be required and are being pressed for by the CAA. So what confidence can we have that this really is going to be on schedule and on budget, and that the impact that the pandemic has undoubtedly had on air services and the aviation sector more broadly is being factored in by yourself and the board in taking forward these proposals that your own consultants, Helios, identified as the costliest and riskiest option?
First of all, to deal with the issue of the pandemic, various airline bodies, various travel bodies put recovery as happening somewhere between 2024 and 2025. That will largely be dependent upon the vaccine rollout and all of the associated infrastructure that goes with that. They are all minded that the domestic markets are the markets that are going to recover the quickest. Now, of the nearly 2 million passengers that Highlands and Islands airports handled pre-pandemic, only a very small number of them, less than I think 150,000, were coming in internationally on BA or in KLM. The vast majority are domestic. So based upon the domestic market recovering first, based upon the entire market recovering more generally by 2024-25, the intention is still to proceed with that rollout. If things change materially because of unforeseen circumstances, then at that point, of course, we will look twice. But at the moment, given these timelines, the intention to proceed as is. In terms of the budgeted figure, Helios, as I say, identified costs that were inside and costs that were outside, and that's why there has been a contingency allocated to it. That contingency was agreed following that discussion with Transport Scotland Investment Decision Board, because we had allocated, in effect, too little contingency, and they had recommended that we allocate more.
But you still think it's sensible, notwithstanding what you said about the likely return of the domestic market ahead of the international market, which I can entirely understand the logic behind, but it still makes sense to proceed with, as Helios themselves have accepted, the costliest and riskiest option, as opposed to looking at options like radar in each of the towers, which CAA have suggested they are quite content to consider along with any other options, and which wouldn't involve the sorts of costs that we're looking at in the centralisation package.
Having identified a significant risk to this piece of transport, of Scotland's transport infrastructure, it's important that we move with good haste to deliver a solution that will ensure that we can give that assurance to airlines and customers that we have that foundation for air traffic control for not tomorrow, not the next 5 years, but the next 15 to 25 years.
And I'll check the record, but I don't think we've been giving any estimates in terms of the communications costs. Those discussions are ongoing. Is there a price that HIAL will not be prepared to pay in terms of taking that forward? It'll be so far down the track now that, in a sense, any further increases in the budget will simply have to be absorbed because we're in too deep now.
We have set what we consider to be a prudent budget, and barring unforeseen circumstances, the intention is to deliver that budget, to deliver that programme within budget. Programme is complex, we understand that. The programme is long, we understand that. But the intention is, with what we have available to us, the resource we have available to us, is to deliver that budget, is to deliver that programme on time and on budget.
Kavina, that's all from me, thanks. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that. I'm going to ask committee members if anyone has a last final question, but in the meantime, I'll call Gail first. Got you, Tom.
Thanks, convener. Yeah, I just wanted to finish up again with a question about the staff. Ingalls, why do you think that staff are so against this proposal? If, as you say, you know, it's going to provide improvements, there's going to be a training centre, you've had engagement with them. To my mind, there are huge issues here, notwithstanding that they feel that there's been trust broken. So why do you think they are so against the proposal? And what can HIAL do to get the trust back with staff? Because that's hugely important.
Okay, the project has always been a complex change management project. It's not a technology project. The technology has been well proven and has been used across the world. It's always been a complex change management project. And from the outset, we've been honest with folk to say it will require movement to that centre in Inverness, not for everybody, but for a large number of folk. And so working on the trust part of it is about ensuring that we take away as many barriers to that flexible approach that we're trying to introduce. So whether that be with the relocation policy that's now with the trade unions, whether it be through a flexible approach to commuting, which is now also with the trade unions, and then getting down to these discussions with folk who do not want to move, and pulling every lever that we have within our grasp to ensure that we deliver the right solution for them. So the trust thing is, it's got many, many sides, many, many strands, and it's all about just building these things up, which is what we're doing just now in these.
Thank you. Thanks, convener.
Okay, Tom Mason.
This project is being implemented section by section, airport by airport. And one of the completion activities is a safety clearance from the Civil Aviation Authority. And that's probably going to be successful for the initial airports, Benbecula and Wick being down the line. What happens if Benbecula and Wick are not approved, and you landed with a sort of half-finished project?
The indications are, from discussing these projects at a local level with the CAA, all of the steps that we've taken so far are the correct steps to take. The CAA do not envisage, as they've submitted in their evidence, that they anticipate any problems. However, that said, what that means to us is that we have to set ourselves a very high bar in terms of the standards, the safety, the business case, the safety case that we put forward. This is working in a regulated industry. It's a very special place to be. It's a very privileged place to be, because if we don't do it right, if we don't do it right, then the regulator won't allow us to do things, whether it be through this project or whether it be through introducing fast rescue craft in Sambara or whether it be through runway design or whatever it is. So the regulator sets a very high bar that we have to achieve. And as I say, it's a good place to be, because at no point is there room for error. At no point is there room for grey areas. Is there no point? At no point is there room for misinterpretation. So the approach that we take to this is a very broad, is a very thorough, is a very detailed process that we go through. And these processes are layered up in the company through different levels of governance, so that everybody has the opportunity at every point to say, I agree this looks okay, or no, this doesn't. So it's not a position I expect to get into, providing we continue to follow the governance processes and the safety processes that we have had in this organisation for some considerable time.
But are you at this moment in a position to walk away from the feasibility?
Sorry, I didn't hear the last part.
Are you at to walk away from the whole project if it's not feasible? Or you can't meet those high bars?
If we don't deliver the project, then we compromise that essential piece of transport infrastructure in the Highlands and Islands. We compromise the ability for airlines to fly and for passengers to travel throughout the Highlands and Islands. So walking away from it is not on our agenda.
But might it be on the government's agenda?
I honestly don't know. That's something you need to ask them.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Can I just a last couple of points? On the question, and you may not be able to give us this information just now, but and I think it's really probably underlined from what Rhoda Grant said, is there a breakdown between staff turnover in Inverness and staff turnover in the islands? So if, for example, disproportionately high turnover in Inverness staff, another staff was very stable, you might actually not be solving the problem you thought you were going to solve. So it would just be useful to get that information. And I think the specific report that Rhoda was talking about, that people had highlighted, was the ECOS location options report. And it would be worth perhaps getting a further response in that. I suppose you talked about the Island Impact Assessment Report, which you've not yet read. But to me, and I wondered whether this was at any point ever in the mind of the board, you said that from the outset, it was clear that people would have to move. It was clear that there was a strategy which took high quality jobs from remote and island communities into the centre. Now, this has happened in the history of the Highlands and Islands. My family left Tyree because there was no strategy for holding people in the islands. And they said, we can't possibly do it anywhere else. A lot of these jobs move, and you can see what's happened in a number of places over a long period of time. But we now have modern technology and a commitment to sustain remote and island communities. So at any point did the board look even at, given the skill sets, given the nature of technology, and I mean, I'm talking about communications technology, being something other than, frankly, which in my view has been the easy option for a very long time, which is to centralise, just centralise. Was at any point ahead of doing the island impact assessment, you thought, I wonder how good a strategy this is, if it's predicated on taking good quality jobs from remote and island communities, given that that is, my understanding, the Scottish Government's own policy, and you're a wholly owned subsidiary of the Scottish Government. So at any point did the board discuss that at the very beginning when you were looking at a project that said from the outset jobs would have to move?
Just a couple of points, Convener, if I may, just on the staff turnover point, I'll very happy send that through, and I'll also highlight that the number of retirees, because they are also included within the staff turnover. So to include them gives that overall picture, if you like. And in terms of the strategy that's adopted, the principal objective of the strategy is to maintain these lifeline links, is to maintain that level of connectivity, is to ensure that these services to Tyree and beyond continue for the foreseeable future. And we do things that, for example, we do look at things differently to try and arrive at appropriate and proportionate solutions. And I give you, for example, your own home, you know, your own ancestral home, if you like, of Tyree, where after many, many years of uncertainty about how we would provide connectivity to Tyree, Barra and Campbelltown, Highlands and Islands Airports purchased with the Scottish Government funding, purchased two Twin Otters because it was becoming increasingly difficult to find these aircraft, to find people willing to invest in these aircraft. And so the government sponsored the purchase of the two aircraft, and now that will last for the next 25, 30 years. So it is about looking long term at these very, very delicate problems. I accept that.
Okay, thanks for that. I recognise that the direction of policy has been to understand that these communities need high quality jobs in order to be sustainable and deliver public services. This, my sense is that if you start from the very beginning with the outset, assuming the jobs will have to be centralised, that's a mindset from the past. And I just wondered if that argument needed to be tested a little more. But I see Maurice Corrie. Right, Maurice. Sorry, Maurice, could you start again, please? We're not. We're not hearing you, Maurice, unless it's just me. Can you unmute yourself? I think we've got a problem with Maurice. Can I suggest that what we do is, unless he can be connected very quickly, no, I think what we'll do is we'll follow up with a question from Maurice at a later time. I think we're now maybe stretched the limits of technology, but he can insert or send some more comments to the panel and see if we can get a response. I think we have come to the end of what's been a very substantial session, and very much appreciate the time from all three of you being here and answering the questions in detail. It may be that we'll want to follow up with you, and we've certainly, I think, Maurice, there's something you want to say. We'll make sure that you have sight of that. And there are some things that you have indicated that you will send further information to us. Of course, as a committee, we will be hearing from the Cabinet Secretary, Michael Matheson, on these issues, and we recognise that some of the quick comments, perhaps some of the ones that I was raising directly with you, are actually, you know, usefully going to be directed at Scottish Government, because it's around policy, which is more than just practical delivery. But we're very appreciative of the time that you've taken to be with us today, and for giving us so much of your time. And we look forward to hearing perhaps what response will be to the Island Impact Assessment when you and the board see that. I think so. We are agreeing that we will meet with the Cabinet Secretary for further opportunity to reflect on what we've heard today and further evidence. And with that, can I thank everyone for attending, including Rhoda Grant and Liam MacArthur, as well as our panel. And I'm going to end, close this part of the meeting and move into private session. And can I remind members to go to Teams in order to do that. Thanks very much.